wanted to take a couple of minutes to talk to you about some of our offers in our electrical and computer engineering department. In this department, we offer a number of different degree programs. So I'm going to start with our audio engineering technology degree program. This is a fairly unique program. It spans actually three different concentrations. The students work on actual sound recording. There's a strong foundation in electronics, so students not only learn how to record music, but also how to design the equipment to record music. And finally, they learn about sound and music appreciation and other things that makes a quality recording.
I chose the University of Hartford because it's the only one out there that has an electronics background, but also goes through the production as well. We have classes in like advanced mixing, and then we also take classes with circuits and capacitors and all that fun stuff. The faculty are always there to help. You can count on them. Even if you can't meet with them, they'll always reply to your emails, get back to you as soon as they can.
I did a lot of technical support. I coupled that with some degrees. I have got an electrical engineering technology degree from the University of Hartford, right here. Picked up an electrical engineering degree from the University of New Haven, and I also got a master's in music technology from NYU. So places where our graduates are working would be Telefunken Corporation. They make some of the greatest microphones in the world for Green Day, Alicia Keys, you name it. A lot of their technical support staff over there are our graduates. We have a really good relationship with them. We just established a relationship with NBC right out of Rockefeller Center, the kind of media icon location that they do a lot of morning shows on major network television. We are going to be placing interns down there on a consistent basis, which was a big win for us. The last three worldwide Olympics, they've only chosen five audio interns. These are paid positions, they're paid for. This is in the host country, most recently in Canada. And out of the five, we've always had at least one or two placed out of our program here. Additionally, we're seeing more and more multimedia websites that are happening. So websites are including more video content, more audio content. We have digital radio. So there's a lot of things that are happening, and all of these require audio to be part of the mix, pun intended. All kinds of places are employing our graduates, and that's really as a result of the technical training. So we put people through a lot of paces in terms of having to learn electronics, having to learn software. They have to take some math classes, there's no way around that. A good example would be my audio systems integration class. The majority of handouts and study material in that class come directly from the manufacturers themselves. So I'm handing out schematics from Fender, from Peavey, and we're looking at technical literature from these companies. And our guys are able to, after that course, wire an entire studio with multiple grounding techniques that can choose which would be best for the application. Okay, so we're here in the analog studio, and you notice I said the word analog. So what we're talking about is not having everything being digitally simulated within a computer. So analog signals come into this machine, and we like to first have our students come in and learn it from the analog viewpoint, because once one knows how it works in the traditional or old school, as they would say, analog fashion, when they learn it in the more modern computer world, they're able to have a much stronger understanding. And just so the viewers of this video are aware, there is a ton of analog gear still being manufactured and being utilized. Just the one last thing, as long as we're in the studio, over here we have a tape machine. A lot of record producers still like to use a tape machine.
I'm sitting in front of one of our Pro Tools stations, or our main digital studio Pro Tools setup. Another piece of equipment that we have, which is right behind me, is our Sony digital console. This is based on the very popular Sony Oxford console, Sony Oxford software, EQs, compressors, things like that. Many of our students have wide-ranging interests, and that's something that this program is actually perfectly tailored for as well, because not only from the production side and the electronics side, but we actually have quite a few electives available. So one can minor in something related to audio, like cinema, for instance, or perhaps business, which seems unrelated, but like I said, many of our students are very entrepreneurial.
The graduates of our AEB-accredited Bachelor of Science in Electrical Engineering will affect the lives of much of the world's populations. These graduates are responsible for designing telecommunication systems, photonics, computer systems, electrical power distribution, and many other things. We have one of the few electrical power labs actually in the Northeast and also in the country. This is a fully equipped lab that we have maintained to actually leading edge technology, including our forays into the new smart grid technology.
I worked in the area of teaching at the University of Hartford for 22 years and in the field of electrical engineering for 40 years. I have done considerable amount of consulting for industry, especially with Westinghouse, General Electric, ABB, Northeast Utilities, and United Illuminating. Presently, with the amount of money President Obama is giving to the electrical smart grid, this is the hottest area as of now. Companies like Northeast Utilities and United Illuminating are hiring on the spot people with a background in power engineering. We had programs in power engineering at RPI and WPI, but both these programs have now vanished, and ours is the only program existing between New York and Boston. Recently, we were awarded the $265,000 grant for 20 seats of the Electrical Transient Analysis Program by Operations Technologies in California. The commercial value of this software is about $1.5 million. Our students use this in most of the graduate level courses, especially to emphasize the concept of power systems analysis. About a couple of years ago, the electrical power engineering concentration was rising its head above the other disciplines, and I had students who had a concentration in the electrical power who were hired right at the beginning of the final semester of their four-year program. These students have gone ahead and taken the master's program and are now enrolled in it, and some of them have already graduated. Of the graduate students we have now, the electrical power stands at almost 50% of the entire population of the graduate students. So it's showing an increase in the enrollment considerably. They will mostly see me at the junior and senior level at the undergraduate program, or the graduate level at the 500 and 600 levels courses definitely. I teach all the controls courses, both the continuous controls and digital controls. I also teach signal processing and random signals and noise, plus all the electrical power courses, especially generalized machine theory, power systems analysis, and transformer theory and practice. There are other courses like power electronics, which I have taught occasionally, but not on a regular basis.
We have computer engineering that is also an ABET accredited program. Similar to electrical engineering, it shares many of the same courses, but much more emphasis on computer hardware, computer software, and computer operating systems. This leads, obviously, to very attractive careers in supporting the computer industry, but the computer industry is becoming embedded in many, many other products, from, in a sense, cake mixers to thermostats. We'll actually now have fairly advanced computers in it. And so computer engineering, technology and computer engineering both work this space of kind of embedded systems and the advancement of computers into most products that we handle and touch every day.
I'm primarily responsible for the computer-related courses, both in the engineering technology and engineering program. And that starts from the first logic course, which is Digital 1, and then logic design in engineering route. Digital 2, microprocessor, microcomputer architecture, interfacing devices. What we cover in the course is mainly the how you can design, you learn how to design the program of logic devices using the basic logic circuits. And we use the Quadris2 software for that, we use Altera trainers for it, and we test it using the National Instruments test equipments for arbitrary waveform generators, and we use logic analyzers to measure our outputs. So it's A to Z design and testing performance. I'm also the associate director of NASA Space Grant Consortium for Connecticut, state of Connecticut, which grants about $600,000 a year to students and faculty to do research in aerospace-related areas. And this university happens to be the leading institution for that consortium. And we offer internships, summer internships, regular internships during the semester. We offer money for projects for students, research projects for faculty members, money for travel, and also there's a helicopter program, training program for it now in Sarkuski this summer. And we have a good relationship with United Technologies companies in aerospace, and we're using that one to offer internship to our students.
So that's the line one on the table, right? Which it corresponds to this state diagram here. You're gonna stay on the 0-0 state if your input is 0, alright?
The equipment I use is mainly, like I said, Quadris2, and we use DT2 board from Altera, which is a board that you can design either your own microprocessor. You can build your own microprocessor with this board. In addition to that, you can also program any logic circuit that you design. You can actually program it into a chip. And we do have an AC11 programmer here that it allows people to use. I've used Cadence heavily in designing schematic capture, schematics. We also use PCB editor for that. We use layout. We use the Allegro simulator to simulate the circuits all beforehand. We use the advanced analysis for that.
I teach electrical and computer. Mostly I teach freshmen right now, all engineering majors, and I teach graduate course, and I teach some junior course. So I teach all. Been around for 15 years, and this is what I do. For example, the freshman year, I teach ES143 called Engineering and Design. The course is about engineering, and what it is also has a component that's called Learning by Discovery. Here is an example. The students were giving a robot kit, and they were asked to come up with a project. There are some projects we give them and some we assign. This is they chose up the project. The project works this way. We have two sensors here. Those two sensors are ultrasonic sensor. Basically what they do, they measure the distance. and they translate the distance to a musical note. As I use my hand for the distance, they play different music notes. So, see? Now. As I go on, if I go on after a while, the robot will be really happy and start dancing. Basically, it will move around by itself. This was the best design for the last year project. Another project my students did, where they took the robot that's normally like this, and they put it upside down, and they use it as a crane. The robot can move by remote control or direction, and the robot also has a motor that can lift things up. People ask about computer engineering because we have a very strong major in computer engineering. Computer engineering is all about interfacing. When you go to the grocery store and you see the self-checkout, that's computer engineering. You have the software, you have the hardware, you have the sensor, you have the barcoding, you have the weight scale where you put scan a gallon of milk, you put it in. If it's not gallon of milk, it'll say something else. If you put a bottle of wine, they will know it's not gallon of milk. That's computer engineering. So those are the things I do and I teach. I teach also a junior level course called Engineering by Design, where students learn about entrepreneurship, how to work together, how to choose a product, how to start a company, how to finance a company, all the patents and the copyright, all those details. Look around, which is very important for students to know. If you look around, anything you see, we are trying to interface it to a computer. Even a mechanical system, a car used to be you put the key and you start the car, and the only thing electrical is the battery and the switch. Now your car is basically controlled by a chip. Everything, your diagnostic system, your sensors, it's full of sensors and controlled by a chip, and all this is electrical. If you look at all mechanical systems nowadays, they are all, somehow we are trying to control them. So that's where electrical and computer engineering are. Our fingers are everywhere. We talk about, take any system, take image processing. Image processing is not biomedical engineering. It's one of the things I do. It's signal processing. It's, you take a signal, which is an MRI, you process it to look for things, abnormalities. Computer engineering students, they know hardware and software. Computer science students know, or major, you can say that, they know software. So computer science is about software. Computer engineering is about hardware and software. Technology students are not into design. To design, you need the math, you need the physics, the background, you need the hardware design background. So when you are an engineer, it means you are to design things. When you are in technology, it means you have to do operation and production. There are some overlaps. You can see an engineer in technology or an engineer going the other side. There is some overlap, but the overwhelming majority are into design. Overwhelming majority are into operation and production. This is the difference. The same thing with electronics engineering technology. So you take an electrical engineer, they don't, first year they do lots of math and design. You take a electronics engineering technology, the first year they go and learn about electronics. They learn about, they take ECT 111, which is electronics DC. They learn about the major. There is no design there. It's courses built up to improve skills, where you hear you have courses to build a foundation for design. You have to have the math, you have to do it. They are two different beasts. They are totally different.
I'm a computer engineer and technology with a minor in electrical engineering technology. The reason why I picked that is because it's more hands-on. So we do more building circuit boards and building microprocessor and building capacitors and building kind of stuff like that.
Programs in what we call EET, Electronic Engineering Technology, are intended to give students flexibility in designing their programs. So you can, we have an associate's degree where you can learn a lot of things for sort of production and installation of advanced electronic systems and leave them with an associate's degree, or stay 2 more years, learn more design and engineering, and then really work on more sort of design-oriented, become a test engineer, production engineer, and many other areas that use electronics engineering technologists.
I was always interested in electrical, so I went straight through school, from bachelor's to master's to PhD, starting at Texas A&M and then ending at the University of Michigan. It was pretty nonstop straight through. And then I worked in industry for about 20 years, 4 different companies, a couple of large Fortune 100 companies like PepsiCo and ITT. And then I got kind of hooked on this entrepreneurial startup notion and did 2 small companies that were actually started from scratch. One ended up going public, so that was kind of fun to build something from nothing. And at that point, I decided I wanted to go into teaching. So I worked for DeVry University for 5 years doing purely teaching, and then I ended up getting a position here 9 years ago at the University of Hartford, and that's been a full-time teaching job as well as now running the department. So it's been a combination of about 20 years in industry and now about 14 years in teaching. We have quite a few labs, we have quite a bit of electronics equipment. Most of it's the same kind of test and measurement equipment you would see in the industry. So we have oscilloscopes and function generators and voltmeters. And it's kind of fun to go build breadboards and test circuits. We also have a lot of software packages that are used now to simulate circuits. Well, one of the things I think that's good here is that our ratio of faculty to students is low compared to a lot of schools. It's easy to get lost when you're in a large program in a large university. Not only are the courses large, but a student's ability to access faculty and to be able to spend some time on a one-on-one basis is really good here. It's pretty easy to find us. There's not that many faculty in the department. We have 12 full-time faculty, so we're easy to locate. We have office hours that are posted, so it's pretty easy to figure out when we're here. And also before, after, during class, when you have small class sizes like we do, which are typically in the range of 15 students, there's plenty of time to be heard. You can be kind of close to what's going on in class, and you have a chance to ask questions, which isn't always the case when you're in a large section.
Sorry, I taught ECT 111, which is basically AC and the DC fundamentals, and another class after that. And also I taught, for example, ECE 231, which is a digital logic circuits. And it's a class also. We have computer science students, and we also have our own engineering students. And also, I know a lot of different departments, they would prefer to take it just to get to know what's digital systems. Those classes, I usually try to, in the sense that I understand that everybody, you know, would forget slowly afterwards, after the exam, final exam done. But I always hope that at the moment they walk out of the classroom, they would have something in their mind they would never forget. And so I always try to connect knowledge with daily common sense stuff. And another class I taught was a digital signal processing. So I taught both the senior level digital signal processing and the graduate student level digital signal processing. And for that class, it's really sort of one of the class they can use to find a job with. You know, it's very, and that major is very career oriented. It's actually one of the most popular class among the students because they can related to digital music. We explain what's MP3. We explain what's a digital picture, and do you sort of realize what's the difference between the digital one versus the non-digital one?
Sort of extracurricular activities are actually quite important because employers these days, of course, they will look at grades, but more important than that, they want to know what experiences you've had. The University of Hartford has the Institute for Electrical and Electronic Engineering, or the IEEE student chapter. There the focus is on professional growth in electrical engineering and electronics engineering.
Well, the thing about engineering is that the different types of engineering they're not discrete, it's all continuous. There's a lot of overlap between the different types, like electrical overlaps with audio, overlaps with acoustical, overlaps with civil, And like nowadays, what a lot of businesses are looking for are people who are kind of skilled in a little bit of everything and who can combine that knowledge, because it's all, based on the same principles. So we welcome you non-electrical people to our meetings.
IEEE is for Institute of Electronics and Electrical Engineers, but this year we brought it out to everyone in the major because I'm computer, so they let me do it too, and I'm the secretary of it. And it's more just a networking, so you can have a bench from everyone from different majors, so they can get together and see what you know how to do and do projects.
Other than studying and being professional, we also do fun stuff. We have some. We had pie days, basically pie each other. It was fun.
Just feel free to think about some specialization and get together and bring your friends and do it. You don't have to be in a meeting to do it, but then you can always say, okay, we'll do this, and all you would have to put on our websites.
The electronics industry continues to grow dramatically in the United States and around the world. It's an area that needs many, many new, young, technically trained people to enter these fields to continue to fuel the worldwide need for computing systems, telecommunication systems, and advanced electronic controls.